August 2016 general meeting of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, the Brockton Area Branch. For those who'd like to join me in our affirmation, begin my meeting by stating that the Lord is blessing me right here and right now. Would you like to join us, please? The Lord is blessing me right here and right now. Thank you and welcome again. We're going to have an abbreviated NAACP meeting tonight. We're just going to have the secretary and the two or three committee people give you updates on some of the activities that we're presently doing. First, we'll have our secretary, Miles Jackson, come forward and give you an update. Miles?
Good evening, everybody.
Amen.
I'm going to talk about our election that's coming up in November of all offices. So if anybody's interested, please contact us. Please note the following general membership meetings of the Brockton Area Branch for the purpose of officers and at-large members of the Executive Committee. On September 26, 2016, at Messiah Baptist Church, 7 p.m., there will be an election of the nominating committee. All members whose memberships are current as of 30 days prior to the meeting date, that means August 26th, may be elected by the nominating committee. On October 25th, 2016, at Messiah Baptist Church, there will be a report of the nominating committee. All members whose memberships are current as of April 1st may be nominated for office or an at-large member of the executive committee. In order to sign a nominating petition or be elected to the election supervisory committee, a member must be current as of 30 days prior to the October meeting. On November 28, 2016, the election of officers and at-large members of the executive committee will take place at Messiah Baptist Church. Polls will open from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. In order to vote in a branch election, one must be a member in good standing of the branch 30 days prior to the election. A form of identification is required when you report. Should a runoff election be necessary, that election shall occur on the following date at time certain, at least 1 hour at this location. Runoff elections shall be conducted not less than 10 days after the original election. We look forward to your participation in these activities. Now, when this ends, if anybody's interested and is current in their membership, we do have election procedure pamphlets out at the desk, out at the table. It's just before you go out. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Miles. Next, we'll hear from our chairperson, Tiffany Niles Ellis, who's going to give you an update.
I just want to give you guys an update. For those of you who have not heard of AXO, the AXO program is the Afro-Academic Cultural Technological Scientific Olympics. That's a lot to say. That's why you abbreviate it for AXO. It's our youth program. It's for students in grades 9 through 12. Every NAACP branch, they sponsor us, our youth program. AXO's been around for several years, but we've brought it back through this branch. We've been going into our third year now, participating. We just recently came back from Cincinnati, Ohio, where we brought with us four students, three competing and one competing in dance, photography, and biology. And one of our students won the gold medal in biology. About this program. It's great for the students. They look forward to it. They can compete in 32 categories, anywhere from the sciences to the performing arts. So we would love to have more volunteers. We start recruiting in October, and then we kick the program off in January. And the program will run from January to April, where we'll host our local competition in April. So we're always looking for students. We're also looking for volunteers. Mentors, judges. So I did leave some information. It looks like this, along with some other information out at the desk. So if you guys want more information on that, please take the panel, sign up. You can email me at theaxo.brockton@gmail.com if you're interested in getting more information. Like I said, we will start recruiting heavily starting October. We did have a table at the Summer Fest just this past Saturday over at the high school. So we're looking forward to it this year. The students will compete locally here in April, and if they win a gold medal, they'll go on to the national competition, which this year is going to be held in Baltimore, Maryland. So if you need more information, please sign up. We would love to have you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tiffany. And now we'll hear from our first vice president, William Brewer, who will give you an update on our Brockton cable access training program. Thank you, William.
Everyone. This is just one of the committees we do have. This is the BCA committee. What we're doing with that committee is we're training our members to operate the cameras. We've completed our first phase of training, which is working with the cameras. The next group, our next phase of training will be the control room, and then we're going to do the remote access. So with that said, we'd like to thank the BCA for being here. In the future, of course, we'll be able to record our own events, and so that's the purpose of the training. So we have currently 8 people in training right now, and so we look forward to increasing that later on. And we are especially looking for the youth to train them in the control room and cameras. So that is our PC training. That's what, again, that's just one of the committees that we have ongoing right now. So with that, thank you, and enjoy the night.
As many of you may know, the Brockton area NAACP has been moving on a prostate cancer initiative. Prostate cancer is one of the leading cancers among men, and it is three times more prevalent among African American and Hispanic men as opposed to the general population, the white population. And we have taken the initiative to bring information forward to the public. We had a forum a couple of months ago that was very successful. We're in partnership with AdmiTech Foundation out of Boston, which is a national foundation that is working on research on less invasive ways to treat prostate cancer. We're currently working on planning for our next event. We're also in partnership with Good Samaritan Medical Center, and at Good Samaritan Medical Center, we'll begin a support group for prostate cancer next month. Dr. Mercado will be the leader of that forum, and we'll be getting information to you forward on our website. This is a very, very important initiative. We want to save our men's lives. Remembering that the NAACP is not only for all men of color, it's for all men and all people that believe that civil rights and human rights are everyone's rights. So we want to make certain that you have an opportunity to work with professionals on preventing prostate health or servicing those who are unfortunately beyond the early stages and giving them comfort. So that is an initiative that we're working very, very hard on. As a segue to our program for this evening, I'd like another one of our executive committee members, Leona Martin, to hand out to you a questionnaire that we'd like everyone to have. Could you do that at this time, Leona? And we have some pens. And it's simple. It's voluntary. It asks the question, why are you here? And it gives us an opportunity to quantify and make a judgment as to what you, the public, thinks not only about the NAACP, but about the subject and the topic of the evening. So if you could take the time to fill it out, and you will have your own pick them up at another time. It has been stated also that the NAACP, as a result of my testifying a couple of years ago before the public, about a resolution relative to charter schools, stating that the NAACP is for public schools. The NAACP is for public schools. And it was announced even on just a few days ago, last week, that the Massachusetts Democrats vote to oppose charter school question. The Massachusetts Democratic Party on Tuesday night voted to oppose a ballot question that would expand charter schools in Massachusetts, putting the party at odds with some members of its legislature. Our local communities cannot afford to lose more money to charter schools, said the former Representative Carol Dunder, a Democratic State Committee member from Wooden, in the state. Already, cities and towns are forced to make budget cuts every year due to the state's underfunding of education and the money lost to charters. If this ballot question passes, it will create a budget crisis in hundreds of Massachusetts communities and hurt the students who remain in our local district public schools. The party's definitive position differs from the verdict of Democrats who run the legislature and have differing opinions of charter schools. Legislative leaders were unable to broker a charter school compromise and have left the issue for voters to settle. Senator Michael Rodriguez, a Westport Democrat, and Representative Frank Moran, a Lawrence Democrat, have both taken on prominent roles back in passage of question two, which would allow up to 12 new charter schools or charter expansions in Massachusetts annually, regardless of statutory cap. The Senate this year passed the RISE Act, tying charter cap expense increases to additional investment in local education at an estimated cost of $203 million to $212 million annually for 7 years. The bill, knocked by the critics who noted the lack of dedicated funding in the bill, which they described as placing an unfeasible burden on increasing access to a form of public education that operates outside the control of local school committees. Rather than seek compromise with the Senate, House leaders abandoned hope of a legislative solution, allowing the question to be decided by voters on November 8th. Mara Dolan, Communications Director for the Senate Presidency, Stanley Rosenberg, entered the fray early Wednesday morning, writing on Twitter, "This just in, Democrats in Massachusetts turn out to be real Democrats after all, vote to oppose increasing charter schools." Lee M. Kerr, Massachusetts State Director of Democrats for Education Forum, which supports expanding access to charters, found Dolan's comments thought-provoking, writing, "LOL, people who thought RISE Act was good faith effort." Governor Charlie Baker and other Massachusetts Republicans backed the ballot question and other means of expanding alternatives to the traditional district-led school, arguing it allows for experimental and oftentimes better education. Many Democrats oppose expanding charter school access, arguing that it saps money from school districts as dollars follow students to charters and subverts local control of school committees. Democrats were gathered Tuesday in Lawrence to choose electors to the Electoral College, and the resolution was offered by Stephen Tolman, the president of the Massachusetts AFL-CIO, according to a party spokesperson who said it passed on a voice vote. According to someone in attendance, there was only a scattering of people who opposed the measure out of nearly 300 at the gathering. Democrats of Educational Reform sponsored two of the breakfast events Massachusetts Democrats held at the Democratic National Convention in Philadelphia, as political Massachusetts reported at the time. Massachusetts Democratic Party Chairman Tom McGee, who was a senator from Lynn, opposes increases to the cap on charter schools and told the news service in Philadelphia that the sponsorship did not reflect the party's position. "It's not indicative of any reflection of what the position of the party would be," McGee said, noting breakfasts had been sponsored by corporations such as AT&T and National Grid. McGee said, "Breakfast events sponsorships cost in the range of $2,500 to $5,000 and allow sponsors the opportunity to address the crowd for a couple of minutes. Acknowledging there is a different perspective," McGee told the news service, "I personally and particularly in the Senate have supported key president of the president of the New England Area Conference of the NAACP and chairman of the campaign opposing question two, praised the position taken by the Democratic Party. They joined more than 70 local communities in a broad coalition of families, parents, educators, students, and local leaders who understand that question two is bad for our schools. Hopefully, in a statement sent out by the campaign to save our public schools, which also reported the party vote. After the Senate voted down the charter school cap expansion bill in 2014, charter school advocates launched a ballot campaign last year, collecting tens of thousands of signatures to put the question before voters. Now, the reason that I bring this up is because nationally, the NAACP has formed a resolution against charter schools, has repeated and substantiated their reasons for it on several annual conventions, and did so again this past July. The NAACP is neither a Democratic nor a Republican organization. However, in this case, we agree with the State Democratic Committee because they agree with us that charter schools are a deficit to the opportunity for public schools to survive. That's an interesting way to segue why we're here tonight, but at least puts us on the educational path and tells you a little bit about the position that the NAACP states about education. And also, it took a little time for Leon to hand out the questionnaires. Hopefully, he'll take a moment to answer some of the questions that we have posed to you so we can quantify and at some point make a statement out to the public of your comments here tonight. There are some ground rules for this evening, and I'm very, very thankful and grateful for everyone coming out tonight. I expect that there will be differing opinions and many questions that will be asked of our speakers this evening. We are going to hear from Reverend Walker, and we're going to hear from Superintendent Captain Smith. Each will have 10 minutes to speak and address on matters that they think most important for you to hear this evening. And then you, the public, will have an opportunity to ask questions of both Reverend Walker and Captain Smith. We ask you to be respectful of the time. There will be questions, and we don't want the long speeches. The speeches and the answers will come from the people who are speaking as our guests. We do have an opportunity to be here, and we want everybody to have an opportunity. The meeting is from 7 to 9 o'clock, and we'll end promptly at 9 o'clock. So, we have Captain Smith up front, and is Reverend Walker in the house?
Yes.
An editorial that was printed in the Brockton Enterprise, or the, I guess it's called the Enterprise, not the Brockton Enterprise, is that correct? This is a region. In the Your Opinion section on 7/25, July 25th, 2016. And my glasses should be this one, because it's been printed a little smaller. Here we go. The title of this editorial, as printed by the Enterprise, is Ghettoization of Brockton School Department Intentional? Do the members of the Brockton School Committee disrespect black and brown Brocktonians? Clearly they do. But are the school committee members intentionally disrespectful? Did they hire the current superintendent for her proven track record and enduring skill of keeping blacks and browns marginalized within the system? Before you discount my concerns as hyperbole or unsubstantiated whining, just walk through 43 Crescent Street and count the blacks and browns you see in upper level positions. How many of Bacchae do you need? The members of the Brockton School Committee regard blacks and browns akin to the way whites in 2016 regard Muhammad Ali, i.e., European Americans who love him in abstract hills. Seeing the 1965
five Ali standing beside Louis Farrakhan are using the N-word would horrify white folks today. Members of the school committee probably never use the N-word unless they are mock burning types. Yet they have no question, they have no problem ensuring ghettoization of the school department. The Reverend Michael Walker, pastor of Messiah Baptist Church in Brooklyn, Brooklyn. So at this time, we're asking Reverend Walker to come forward and address us relative to the editorial. And I'm sure that he will handle himself well, because it has, we've received critical comments, both of the school committee, the school department of Michael Walker, and general comments from the public. And I expect that in your questions and in the answers, you'll have some interesting dialogue. And that is the reason why we're here tonight, to begin a dialogue. If you have a good product, you want to make certain that that product stays on the top of the list. And one way to do that is to receive constructive criticism. If you take that constructive criticism and work with it, okay, you are sure to make your product and keep your product as one of the best. And I think that Brockton has the opportunity of having or keeping, in some people's minds, their educational system among the best in Massachusetts. That's my opinion. That's your opinion? Is it your opinion? Let's find out what you have to say tonight. But let's first begin with Reverend Michael Walker, addressing the audience. Thank you very much.
Test.
He answered the same number of questions, asked the same items that the IQ test asked. The point is, what's taken as intelligence is cultural homogeneity. And the biases of the questioner, all the biases, if you ask a kid what's a sofa, it's not a matter of intelligence. It's a matter of, do they know a sofa or do they know a couch? If you ask CP time, or if you ask what's a deuce and a quarter, it's not a matter of intelligence. It's a matter of culture and of a language. So what's the point? It's important that we not mistake culture for intelligence. And it's important that we not mistake language for intelligence. Because what one person sees as a couch, another sees as a sofa. What one sees as a Buick, another sees as a deuce and a quarter. And by the way, you did start on CP time tonight. But that's not an issue, because if you don't know the culture, then you're just ignorant to what CP time is. But we won't blame that on your ignorance. We'll just say, not your culture. The problem comes when someone has the power to enforce their culture and name their culture intelligence, and then penalize others for their lack of culture. So what's the point? What's the point? I heard the setup tonight. You heard the setup too, obviously. So what will we do? What will we not do? Demonstrative. We will not, and I say we in the plural, Ada Legion, the good people of Ada Legion Parkway, and me, we will not seek to place blame. Because the important thing is not placing blame. We will not seek to be combative and to have a personal battle with this superintendent, who is a good soul, and a wonderful soul, and a remarkable soul, and a committed soul. We will not have combat. We will not seek to place blame. What will we do? We will seek to work together for common purpose, for common cause, for shared mission, to find a way forward for our children and for our community. Because we're all in this together. So what is my schedule? And I don't know. Maybe where we're meeting tonight, folk might get used to these time parameters around here. What's the point? We will seek to work together, find common cause going forward. What's my concern? I have serious concerns, and I am certain that the superintendent and many of you share this concern. I am deeply, deeply concerned that the current system severely disadvantages the students, the staff, and the citizens of Brockton that call themselves white. And I say that call themselves white because those that now call themselves white haven't always called themselves white. They call themselves Catholic, Welsh, Jewish. They call themselves by lots of other names, but now they choose to call themselves white. And the current system severely damages those that call themselves white, because they can literally grow up and see what they see in Brockton as normative, as the world. And it's not. This system setup. And yes, it is a setup. Yes, it is a setup. And from setups can come positive results, okay? I think the writing of the editorial was a setup, okay? Because it inspired us to ask the question, do you agree, do you not agree, do you understand? I don't know that Reverend Walker's 7-minute talk has put you in a better position of understanding, okay? But I do know that what he has done here is very courageous in that he is willing to continue the dialogue so that we do all understand
Amen.
What our position is.
Right.
It is. We're in his church,
yeah.
Or in the Lord's church, okay? This is an opportunity, however, for you to maybe disagree with the pastor. Or maybe agree with the pastor. He's not here to have you agree or disagree. He's here to have you think. Think. And that's why next we're going to bring forward one of our best thinkers in the city. Kathleen Smith is our superintendent of schools, and we'd like to hear from you.
And all of you that are here this evening. I do think it's important. I have some prepared statements. I absolutely love to talk to crowds and certainly to hear, you know, some of your thoughts. I couldn't agree more, and I want to start out by saying that Reverend Walker and I go way back. And I'm talking about way back in my beginning years in the Brockton Public Schools. Some of you out there look at me, you've probably seen me at school committee meetings, maybe around the community, and I think it's very important tonight that I actually reintroduce myself to you since I've been in the Brockton Public Schools for just about 40 years. So please bear with me. I have some prepared remarks. Also, I'd like to speak to you from the heart about some things I truly feel about Brockton and the Brockton Public Schools. And I couldn't agree more with Reverend Walker, with Steve Bernard, that what should come out of this evening is a dialogue, a constructive dialogue, a way to move forward, because I will tell you, having lived in Brockton many years, having worked with our children, I truly believe sometimes when I look out at our nation right now, and things bother me as an educator, and it bothers me when I see some of the things our children are exposed to, I often say to myself, Brockton is better than what I'm seeing around the country, and I hope all of you believe that. And that's what we'll need if we're to come together and come up with some solutions to things that we have as concerns. So my prepared remarks. I am pleased to be here this evening to speak at the NAACP Forum on issues we all care about in this community. Many of you know I have been in the Brockton Public Schools for my entire career. I will begin this school year on September 1st, where I will welcome 1,400 teachers and administrators to the 2016-17 school year. When I enter that auditorium at Brockton High School, it will be the start of my 40th year in Brockton. I share that with all of you because I am proud of the work I have been a part of these many years. I have supported the neediest students and families throughout the district. I was originally hired as a Title I teacher, 1977, of students in what were considered to be schools with high poverty rates. I made sure I connected with those students, with the parents, with the community, to always come together to support these children. I began at East Junior High School in 1983. I worked as a special education teacher for students that had severe disabilities. And I need to talk to you about East Junior High at the time. Those of you that lived in Brockton know that the city was really neighborhood schools. And I actually happened to live close to the Stoughton line, the house that I live in to this day with my husband and my two daughters who are grown and moved away. And at that time I was assigned to East Junior High. And I remember hearing about East being on the east side of the city, is that there were many minority children that went there, many students that were studying our linguistic minority population, and students that came from the so-called projects, and some of the toughest kids in the city to work with. When I went there, I spent my first few years there developing what I felt was a climate and a culture of change. This was a school, when you looked at west and south, they used to have end of the year celebrations where parents would hire limousines, where the students would go with beautiful gowns on and come to an eighth grade graduation ceremony. None of these things existed at East Junior High at the time. I was so proud of the fact, and I will tell you, working right alongside me was one of your very own members, Jean Merrill, who was a new assistant principal at the time, later to go on to be the principal at Brockton High School. I loved working with him. I know he thought it was a pain in the neck because we were continually bringing great things to these kids. We had a dance. I can remember that day. I couldn't have it in the evening, but I could have it from at least 5 to 7 o'clock. The kids were wonderful. They walked to this event. They came in beautiful dresses. The parents walked them there. The teachers got involved. A totally new culture and climate at East Middle School. We continued to do things with student council. Martin Luther King Day, and Reverend, that's when you and I actually met each other for the first time. Did things in that school to, again, honor the memory of Martin Luther King and talk about ways that we could make this community better. I got involved in peer groups, student leaders for our minority students and all our students at East. You know, this was the making of, again, my working in the Brockton Public Schools. I went on from there to become a school adjustment counselor in the district. I left East, went to North, worked in many of the elementary schools, and continued my work in this district, many times going into the homes of families that truly needed support, some of the poorest families in the district, some of the families that suffered trauma and needed the support of the schools and certainly the adjustment counselor in that building. I loved that role. I loved being part of the solution. I loved being part of bringing us all up together, making sure that these children had every opportunity to certainly succeed in our district. I became the director of community schools, and again, I'm jumping over many years when you're talking about 40 years. And one of the first goals I had when I looked at the community school advisory board, because at the time we had lots and lots of grants in the schools, lots of ways to support families. And what I found on this board was there was very little diversity. We made sure that there was an outreach to the community. Ozzie Jordan, Jay Stewart, with a young fourth grader at the time. People that came on board to have fundraisers and support our kids so parents had access to programs. Our kids had after-school programs. This, again, was what I felt best about. It was bringing this community together for certainly the greater good. I am proud to be your superintendent of schools. And again, you all know it's during a very challenging time in our city, our state, and our nation. I'm proud to have lived and worked in Brockton for these many years. My own children are certainly graduates of the Brockton Public School System. As I told you, I've lived in the community for well over 35 years. But I do have to make this statement. The comments made in the Enterprise newspaper do not define me in my role for the past 40 years in the Brockton Public Schools, and certainly not the way I have lived my life in this community. I have respected all people and all cultures and all walks of life. I do not look to marginalize any group of people. I have spent my entire career in Brockton looking to bring people together. The comments made were divisive at a time when we are dealing with challenges and when we need to come together to address areas that do concern our entire community. This includes supporting those 18,000 students that depend on us as adults and community leaders to find ways to move our community forward. While we have struggled as a school district to diversify our teaching workforce, like school districts across the Commonwealth of Massachusetts and the country, I am confident that we are making inroads in dealing with this challenge. Just Friday in the Boston Globe, an article titled, "Minority Teachers Hard to Find," a study by Brookings Institution and the National Council on Teacher Quality identified several challenges school districts must address to increase the ranks of minorities leading classrooms in our nation's schools. They are: few minority college graduates are choosing to become teachers, a leaky recruiting pipeline. Minority teachers only make up about 18% of the education workforce across our country. In Brockton, we do have a number of district initiatives to increase minority hires, to bring teachers into the classroom, and to increase our administrative minority roles. We have an administrative internship program where teachers that have been in the Brockton Public Schools for over 4 years have master's degrees, have an interest in going into administration, have an opportunity, and that is every one of them to interview. This year, I think we interviewed, and I do have those numbers, I'm glad to share some of that with you, 36 teachers that put their applications in. Every single one of those teachers was interviewed, and when we look to bring usually about 7 or 8 administrative internships during the last 8 weeks of the school year, we make sure that we are looking at our minority teaching force, because we're looking, again, to raise them up and to have opportunities in administrative positions. You have to start somewhere. We also have something that we're applying for, and this has been something we started as part of my strategic plan when I came on board in 2013. We brought together the presidents from all of the local colleges. I'm talking UMass Boston, UMass Dartmouth, Bridgewater State University, and Massasoit, to talk about a grow your own model. Because tonight I do have one of the members, the assistant director of our human resource office, Elisa Martineau. Elisa and I taught together for many years at East Junior High. She has gone on to an administrative role, and we will talk to you about the challenges that we have faced over the years. Many of the things that Elisa has done as part of the office, going down south, looking to recruit minority teachers, going to black colleges, and looking to see if we could bring teachers and encourage teachers to come to Brockton. And most of that has not been with much success, for reasons I'll let her share. I'm happy to go into that with you. But you talk about the one thing that we do have here. We just graduated over 1,100, I want you to think about that number, 1,100 students from Brockton High School, Edison Academy, a number of Champion High School, a number of our other alternative programs, Gateway to College at Massasoit, which is a collaboration for the Brockton Public Schools. We do not let any student fail if we can help it. We make sure that there are alternative pathways. So when I say to you 1,100 students graduating, many going on to colleges, many of them are John and Abigail Adams scholarship winners, and when you look at those students, they look like all of us in Brockton. When you look at that National Honor Society, they look like all of us in Brockton. The problem is lying, and I can sit here and talk to you about, in the strategic plan, a grow your own program. Because when I look at that large number of graduates and the kids that are successful, I have to say to myself, and we have to say to ourselves, why aren't those children going into education? Sharon Wolder, the principal at the high school, and I talk about this often. And we talk about sometimes first-generation students choosing to go into business, choosing to become doctors, lawyers. You know the drill of things that they're choosing. I think we need to be asking ourselves, we have the brightest kids here in Brockton. We have successful kids that are comfortable coming into the Brockton Public Schools, working with the youngest student to the most difficult students. And why aren't they coming here? I said to Reverend Walker, when we had an opportunity to speak probably about 2 weeks ago, that it's a conversation I have had, maybe it's time to come forward. I kidded Reverend Walker that at my church, and it is a Catholic church, you do not get up and talk from the pulpit. So the opportunity to come to some of our churches, to reach out to the clergy, and to say, we need to do a better job in our homes of encouraging our students to go into a noble profession. And not only to go into that profession, but as Reverend Walker stated, what is happening when some students do that and are not able to get jobs? There are lots of people that are unable to get jobs, and I'm happy to address some of that. But do we need to do things better? Do we need to make sure as a community we're helping them preparing resumes, getting ready for those interviews, providing those portfolios so you have an opportunity when you are interviewing with a principal in a school who has the hiring authority, and that is by Mass General Law. That is when every form came in 1993. It was that the principals would do the hiring because the accountability lied with them. And if schools are not performing, it is very draconian what happens. They come in and the principal is immediately removed after given so much time to make sure the achievement scores are acceptable of the students. And there's a formula for that. If not, they replace the principal. They replace 50% of the teachers. So the principal is allowed to be that hiring authority, to make sure the teachers that they're hiring, the MTAs, monitor teacher assistants, the paras that they're hiring, anybody that has anything involved with the instruction of those students, the principal is the hiring authority, the superintendent approves that hiring. So we need to do a better job. There are many initiatives I'll be happy to talk to you about. I'm sure it will come out when you ask your questions and I'll be able to address that. I think my 10 minutes is pretty much just about up. So I do want to say in closing, I thank you for giving me this opportunity. I look forward to hearing from you, and as Reverend Walker said, what will come out of this meeting will be where we go from here as a community to address your concerns. So thank you.
Thank you, Superintendent Smith. The superintendent had agreed to come to the NAACP meeting months and months ago, and because our schedules didn't quite jive, we, not until today, have the opportunity to meet with her and have her address. But she's always been willing to come before us, and we thank her for that. It's this time in the program that you have a chance to be heard. Before we call you to the microphone, I want to make certain that you take a moment, please, to help us quantify the reason why you're here tonight so that we can make some valuable assessment of what has happened here this evening. And what has happened here this evening is yet to happen unless you are willing to get up out of your seat and speak your mind. Ask the questions that are on your mind. And you heard Kathleen Smith and you heard Reverend Walker say that in this church, we allow you to express your opinion. Is that not true? Yeah, I get the okay. So, if we could have three or four people at a time stand up to the microphone in the middle here and have Reverend Walker and Kathleen Smith, Superintendent Smith, come to one of these tables.
Steve,
coming forward?
Yes. Excuse me, could you introduce the school committee? A lot of us don't know who they are.
I'll allow Kathleen Smith to do that, please. Reverend Walker, would you come up here and I'll move to the audience.
Members of the school committee that are here this evening, I want to make sure I've seen all of you. I see Tom Minicello, Ward 1. I see Tim Sullivan, Ward 7. I know Brett Gormley, Ward 4, is down the back. Trying to see anybody else that I've missed for a school committee. I see our principal, Sharon Wolder, sitting down the back. In the front, I already introduced you to Lisa Martineau, who is our assistant director in our human resource office. Michelle Bolton is our fairly new communications director. We welcome her to Brockton. And Mike Thomas is my right-hand man. He is the deputy superintendent of the Brockton Public Schools.
So if the first public person would introduce yourself and direct your quote, indicate to whom you're directing your question. If you have a pre-statement, we ask that it not be more than 60 seconds so that we don't get into people making speeches. We have people who are going to answer your questions here. So, wonderful. Thank you all again. Please go right ahead, ma'am.
Okay, my name is Tony Lewis. I obviously am a member of the Brockton community. I have to be honest, I did not grow up in Massachusetts. I'm from upstate New York, a little city. I had about 15,000 people, and all the black people were related to me. So certainly you understand that I understand Reverend Walker's concerns that the school committee, the teachers, everybody, they should be reflective of the children that they're serving. But my question is a little different, frankly. I live over on Bel Air Street, and there are lots of schools in the area. What I don't understand is, why are kids out of school so often? I mean, I come out at 1 o'clock, there's buses taking the kids home. At 9 o'clock in the morning, the kids are going to school. When I was growing up, I had to be in my seat by 7:50. We did the Pledge of Allegiance and the prayer, we started class. Can somebody help me with that?
To whom are you directing your question, please?
Anyone who can give me an answer.
Well, first of all, the children are in school 180 school days a year. That is by law. As far as the times go, one of the things we do struggle with, and you'll hear me talk about budget, and this has been another difficult year for budget, we do have a three-tiered busing system. You know, we end up with about 50 buses, and by having a three-tiered system, it allows us just to pay for those 50 buses. We bus, you know, well over 9,000 students in the Brockton Public Schools all over the city, different levels. So because of those three tiers, Brockton High is obviously our largest with over 4,300 students up there with the first track of buses. That's very early. Your middle schools and a couple of our K-8 school come in the next tier, and the last tier are, of course, our youngest, our elementary students. As far as days, one of the things that we have done in this calendar is it's a struggle with all the mandates from the Department of Education to get in the teacher training, the in-services, the requirements that are needed to basically do the job with curriculum and instruction. Because it is so costly, and I will tell you, a year ago, we had election day off. We decided because of the schools being polling places, we shouldn't have the children there. There had been accidents in other school systems. It's a very busy place during an election. So when taking that day off, I saw that as a gem, an opportunity to get the teachers for that full day to do in-service, to do trainings, to do instruction with our teachers. And that was at a cost of over $500,000, because that becomes an additional day, and our teachers are on contract. Because of that, we have instituted a number of half days. So during those 180 days, we can have a number of half days where the children come from for a half a day. It does count as a full day, and then we're able to do the last 3 hours in service with our teachers. So that might be what you're seeing. Okay. Yeah, I'm not sure.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker, please introduce yourself.
Yeah. My name is Edward Downey, past president of the Brockton NAACP, an elder in the church. I am involved in three prison ministries, founded the Mainspring Shelter Share Prayer Program. I'm here tonight, and in answer to your question, I am here to see what the NAACP's position is, if you will, in everything that is going on. Very briefly, I was born in Barbados, West Indies. Mother left me when I was three. My brother and I stayed with my grandmother. Growing up, I saw this man and this woman every day. My mother had eight siblings, and it wasn't until one day I came home, and in this lady was in the house was a white lady. And my grandmother says, "Eddie, come, I want you to meet your grandmother." Little kid, and I'm saying, but you're my grandmother, you know. And she says, "This is your daddy, is my grandfather's mother." Until that time, I did not realize the dynamics. Then that went on, but then another time I came home, and I said, "Where's my grandmother?" Because she was always at the window. My mother's mother said, "She's in the bedroom." I said, "Can I go see her?" She said, "No." It wasn't until later on that two men, neatly dressed, came to the house and went into the bedroom and came back out. And it wasn't until they came back out that I realized that my grandmother was dead. In Barbados, if you died early enough and you had nobody come in overseas, you could be buried the same day. At this funeral, I had never in my life seen so many white people in my life. I had not seen them before. Make a long story short, my grandfather being white, my grandmother being black, he went to one church, she went to another church, and she took all the children. Now, you're saying, what's this all about? Important enough for me, growing up, I didn't realize the impact that all those things had had in my life, and then growing up and seeing the issues that's coming here, and in Brockton is the NAACP, I'm concerned about NAACP and who we are and what we are doing. Brockton has a problem, a great racism problem. We don't want to talk about it, we don't want to address it, we don't want to look at it, we want to hide it, and we don't want to talk about it. Now, I'm saying that with the NAACP, I am hoping and praying that we get to the point that the things and dynamics that are happening here in the city, if we act on them before they come a reaction, I think that some things can change. NAACP is not a black organization. I've said this all along. NAACP was founded by some white people who were concerned about how black people were treated. So it was funded by white folk who were concerned about all of us. And if we can get to that point that we can be concerned about the whole city at large, we'd have not a problem. And I'm hoping and praying that the NAACP, for us, what we need to do is get out and be proactive and set things up and get things going so that we can have a dialogue with what's going on. Not a case where, because of a position we hold, we might be tight with the people in the city or otherwise, but because of the issues that we have in the city of Brockton. In the prison, when I go into the prison, I see a lot of people that come out of our communities, and they come out of communities, and a lot of things they get into is because of the dynamics of racism in our city. We've got to do a better job.
Thank you, Mr. Downey. I believe that the question is, what is the NAACP's position? The NAACP, of course, is made up of individuals. And as individuals, we have varying opinions. And if we're talking about this specific reason for being here tonight, our members have differing opinions. So it is important that we find out three things: not only what we think, what the public thinks, and what the school department thinks, and how we're all going to work together. So as Mr. Downey said, yes, we are dialoguing, and we are quantifying, and we are getting your opinions, talking about your opinions, talking about our opinions, looking at our constitution and bylaws from the national organization, from the regional and the state conferences, to make certain that we're in compliance with the NAACP as a national body before we make a statement that is out of order with the organization and the rules of the organization. Unfortunately, we are determined to stick by the rules. We will be making a statement. This is the first process in our decision-making plan. And I thank you for the participation. But I do thank you for that open statement that things need to be done. And I hope that all of you in spirit are members of the NAACP. You just need to stop at the membership table, join, and let your voice be heard so that you can have some input in our statement plan. So with that, the next speaker, introduce yourself.
Thank you.
Good evening. Your question.
Good evening, Mr. Bernard. Thank you. Just giving honor to the Spirit of Christ that's in this place, honor to the superintendent, all the officials, State Representative Holmes, good to see you. Just want to say, my name is Steve Abrams. One thing I noticed, and it is a question for both of you, how did I go to school? I see the Yick is here. Sometimes we forget how to live. The young people, they just live. We all tight. So we can loosen up and we can have the conversation, even if it's don't go our way. So how did I go to school? I went to school with two police motorcycles up front, paddy wagon in the back. How did I go to school? They was there to protect me. But when I got to school, their assignment changed, their alignment changed. They wasn't there to protect me no more. They was there to arrest me. So how did I go to school? Paddy wagon in the back, two police escorts up front, 74 through 82. 79. So they was there to protect me, but their assignment changed, their alignment changed. I was miseducated. So what did I do? I had to find out ways to master algebraic equations. I had to find out how to open up African-American literature. Traveled the world. Found out what the world thinks of us. Wow. I was miseducated. Thousands of people of color live in suffering from the same condition, miseducation. Would you agree that our people, if you don't believe it, research it. We have to agree to something, because words do matter.
Words matter.
You see, words do matter. So the easiest question to ask is the one you already have the answer to. So would you agree there has been a cultural whitewash, no pun intended, whitewash of teaching Yick? Teaching people who look like me. This has been happening for 38 years, since I can remember going to school. Miseducation. So the conversation is, how do we mend the fence? All three of my children, college graduates, Brockton High School. I've seen the bridge built strong when my kids was coming up. I refuse to let that bridge be destroyed and let these other young people, they are my kids too now. I look at them, I said, you're my responsibility, crack the book. What's the book? The basic instruction before leaving Earth. So what did I do? How did I go to school? So would you agree that there has been a disconnect of honest, thoughtful conversation to move forward, not to hide behind walls or not to build walls, because words do matter. So the easiest question, what am I gonna do? I'll be your candidate for school department, school committee member. That's what I'm gonna do to make sure that bridge continues to be mended. So I say, the easiest question to ask is the ones we already have the answer. That's how I went to school.
Thank you. Would either of our guests want to respond, or if you heard a question there, agree? If not, we'll go to the next.
First of all, thank you, Reverend. You know, first of all, whenever we hear about somebody wanting to go for a school committee, we're very pleased, because the most important asset that we have, and I think every one of us agrees, are those 18,000 children that I mentioned. As far as what we're teaching in school, one of the things that is our goal from the minute that child gets to us as a preschool or kindergarten all the way through 12th grade is that high school diploma. It's important that we educate them based on the standards, based on the curriculum frameworks, based on what we need to do to make sure whether we like it or not. And it's different from when I went to school, I agree. You know, I loved being able to have some of those dialogue or courses or, you know, things that I found interesting. We very much have prescripted things happening, especially when you get to high school. On a happy note, one of the things that happened last year in bargaining with the teachers is we've gone from a 3-period teaching day to a 4-period teaching day starting on September 6th when the students return. And why is that a good thing? Because you can start to talk about, right now, Principal Wolder and her team are looking to bring electives and courses, and maybe there is an opportunity for some of those additional coursework, if that's what you're saying, you know, to bring and to educate our youth. And I agree. I see some of the youth here. I've had some interesting conversations with a number of them. And again, you know, we are certainly dedicated to making sure as a community our success isn't measured just by those graduates, but measured by what those graduates become. And are they able to give back to the community and become productive citizens? So thank you.
Thank you, Superintendent Smith. Our next guest.
Good evening. My name is Leonard Alkins. I've been a resident of this city for 40 years, a homeowner for 40 years, had 2 children go through the Brockton public school system. My question is for the superintendent. First, I want to commend you for your article and bringing the issue to the head. The issue is to answer the question, why is it that the school employment in the office of the superintendent looks more white than diverse? And, you know, you can have a chance to answer that. But I think that's important. That's an issue not only in the Brockton School Department, but it's an issue in the city of Brockton, in all agencies. When you look at Public Works, when you look at the Park Department, you look at all these agencies in the city of Brockton, and you don't see the diversity. You know, the taxpayers, those who are homeowners, those who rent, are entitled to these positions. Everything is not a union job. There are discretionary jobs that mayors, superintendents of schools can appoint people of color to these positions who are qualified. And qualifications is arbitrary. You determine whether or not that person has the skills that you need. In the Brockton Public School System, first I want to commend the Brockton Public School System because it's the best kept secret in the city of Brockton, in the state of Massachusetts. We don't get the credit for what is taught in our school system. Yes, we need more resources, but it's all about taxes. It's all about the system that brings the revenue in to provide the resources. And we can talk about that at another day. I believe in dialogue. I believe that you can disagree without being disagreeable. But let's face reality as it is. The time is now to show by action and not by, well, we're trying. I don't want to hear we're trying anymore. I want to see the action of putting people that look like the city of Brockton, whether they're Cape Verdeans, whether they're Puerto Rican, whether they're African Americans, they're entitled to work like everybody else, and we need to hold people's feet to the fire and get the job done. Thank you.
Superintendent or Reverend Walker, would you like to respond to either one? Would you like to respond first?
I would like to respond. When you talk about the Brockton Public Schools, I think we are talking about a couple of different things. And again, when I talk about our teaching force, our teaching staff, I can read for you, and I brought a list here, and it's amazing we even have any openings with the budget we have and what we have done with reducing our education force this past year. So I have all those figures. But one of the things that I will say, in looking right now, and these are in schools, we need a grade kindergarten inclusion teacher, an English as a second language teacher, a speech and language pathologist, a special education moderate special needs teacher, a music teacher, an instructional resource specialist. We need a Chinese teacher at the high school, tech ed. I could go on, and these are the professional positions. I will go right back to the principals do the hiring in the schools and the superintendent approves. And our principals very much are looking for a diverse workforce. We just had two openings as principals in our district. We put that job application on what's called School Spring. And those of you that are in any kind of education understand that that's where you go to look for jobs. We put that out internally to get people to apply. Now, when you put an application out, we look at all of the applications, and we selected probably from about 25, we selected 10 people to interview. Now, when those people came forward, there were no minority candidates there. Why? They're not in the pipeline, and that's exactly what I just talked about. We ended up going from within. We are not having people apply for those jobs. If, in fact, and I'll ask you right now, you have a candidate with a principal credential, and this, and again, the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education is very tough on highly qualified teachers having proper licensure, proper certification before you can be placed in a particular job. I'll ask you to come forward tonight. We have applications here for paraprofessionals, for monitor teacher assistants, which are entry-level jobs, but many times the paraprofessionals and the monitor teacher assistants have an opportunity to go into a school, work with the principal, and many of them go back and get their bachelor's degree. Monitor teacher assistants already have their bachelor's degree. They have an opportunity for the principal that's doing the hiring of making sure that they are the person when a full-time job comes up, and when I say full-time, I'm talking as a teaching professional. On another note, when you talk about looking like Brockton, we just had an application process where we needed to hire two new school police officers. Two of our police officers on the school department police force, which do have special police powers, but are not part of the Brockton Police Union or part of our Brockton Police. They're school police. And I will tell you, with all of the applicants, we had our school Lieutenant Mills interviewing with an interview committee. And the top four, because they do have to go through extensive background checks, were four minority candidates. They were excellent. Two of them are Brockton High grads, one a man, one a woman. Both are college graduates. The four were minority candidates. You'll end up with two new police officers on that force, and it does look like Brockton. We put out a custodian ad, and you look at that. That's not marginalizing. That's an excellent job for a family. It's an excellent job. We have over about 125 custodians in the system, and you look, they look like Brockton. I'm actually thrilled when I'm seeing women come on board as custodians. We hadn't had that, and they're some of the best workers out there. So when you look at the change in Brockton, it is starting to look like what we look like as a community. Our difficulty is absolutely in the teaching roles. And that's something I'll continue to have dialogue with you, but we look like the Brockton community. We continue to make inroads. And do we have more work ahead of us? You know, we certainly do. And again, I'm willing to continue that work.
Thank you, Superintendent. Reverend Walker, would you like to make a comment?
Yeah, part of what we absolutely cannot do, and this country has done it since 1619, is to cast the blame on the victims. So the people that are least responsible, so literally, to tell me to raise people to do it, or find people, or motivate people, or encourage people, it's not my job to do it. It's the system's job. But yet, it's so much easier to keep, as long as we allow the status quo to stay the status quo, there are always rules in place to make sure it's nobody's fault. Everybody's just following the rules. We followed the rules. We went through the process, went through the procedures. Nothing changes because of institutional inertia. And the best way to keep things in place is through institutional inertia, where nobody has to be accountable for it.
Thank you, Reverend Walker. Our next speaker, introduce yourself, please.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Angel Cosme, and I'm wearing multiple hats here tonight. I'm a community organizer for Brockton Interfaith. I do that full time. I'm a licensed teacher and former teacher in Brockton and other places for about 4 years. I'm also a parent of a 13, soon to be 14-year-old who's going into the high school. So I'm wearing all of that as I come in here today. But really, I have a critique, I have something to commend, and I have an opportunity to collaborate that I want to share with everyone. So I'll start with the critique. I'm making myself a little vulnerable here, but the greater good of what I'm gonna say is what's at stake. There's a lot of rhetoric about hiring qualified teachers of color in Brockton. I'm not saying I'm the best teacher in any sense of the word, but I have a master's degree in education, I have a license in history, a license in special education, and moderate disabilities and sheltered English instruction. And I'm from Brockton and I'm Puerto Rican. Right, and so I applied for Brockton High to teach, and I went to 2 interviews, and I didn't get the position, and that's fine, right? May the best candidate win, but I feel like I'm qualified, and I'm from Brockton. I have a lot to offer the students, and that didn't happen to me. That's my critique, because you know that's I hear a lot of the rhetoric around that. With that said, I'm very happy working for Brockton Interfaith because I get to work on social justice issues like education. So I'm very much still involved and I'm happy there. So I just wanted to note that. So that's my critique. My opportunity to commend Brockton Public Schools and the school committee and others is for a recent email that went out where Bradley and Bishop Tony Branch and others brought to the attention of the school committee to eradicate the term housemaster. So that term is now gone from Brockton Public Schools, right? That's a start. So I commend the school committee and everyone who made that happen. The opportunity to collaborate has to do with Brockton Interfaith forming an education committee. Many members of the education committee are in this room. Messiah is one of our strongest supporters. And we are meeting every 2 weeks at the BIC office, 65 West Elm Street, from 6 to 7:30. So anyone who cares about educational issues in Brockton, whether or not you're affiliated with a congregation, you're more than invited to these discussions. We don't have all the answers, but collectively, we're building something. And tomorrow, in particular, I want to mention that we're having a Know Your Rights workshop. Again, held at Brockton Interfaith, which is 65 West Elm Street, at 6 p.m. And it's going to talk to community members about students' basic legal rights when they are disciplined in school. And so it's an opportunity to learn about what rights parents and students have and to ask questions, and this is hosted by the Justice Center of Southeast Massachusetts. We have a couple of representatives in the back there. But I encourage the community to come out to that. And like I said, we're meeting every couple of weeks. We're tackling issues of diversity, budget issues, and we hope to have continued meetings to these discussions with anyone who's looking to create changes. And I appreciate this kind of conversations because we're talking about something very difficult, very contentious, and yet we're in the room because we want the same thing. So shout out to everyone who put this together. Thank you.
Reverend Walker or Superintendent Smith, would you like to comment, please?
I'm happy to comment. Angel, I've had the opportunity to certainly meet with you a number of times, and I hope you continue again to get opportunities. I'm glad to speak with you. You know, people do go for jobs, and the one thing that I can say, I'm happy to do some follow-up with you. I'm not exactly sure of your particular situation, but I'll be happy to follow up with you. And as far as an education committee that you're talking about, please keep me aware of it. I'm not able to attend tomorrow evening. But if you certainly keep me aware of it, we can talk about moving forward if you would like representation from the Brockton Public Schools in whatever form that takes.
Our next speaker.
Hello, my name is Leland Jackson. I'm a third year student here at Massasoit. I'm studying sociology right now. After Massasoit, I'll be moving on to UMass Boston to try to get my bachelor's. Probably not gonna stop until I get my doctorate because I love my work. My biggest address, I guess, to the community, especially to the black community, a lot of times I don't think that we analyze our history to its fullest extent. What you gotta understand is how the educational system was brought about. Compulsory education that was first mandated by Massachusetts in 1852 determined that everybody should go to school for a certain period of time to gain education. Now, the primary focus for that education was just to assimilate immigrants, educate them well enough so they can get a proper education, so they can just do what you tell them to do, right? One thing that we face in the black community is the economical inequalities that we face. We can't get credit lines to the banks, so we can't open up businesses. We can't get credit lines to the banks, so we can't fund our own school systems. So what you gotta realize is that when you really take our history into its fullest extent, look at what we go through. We get indoctrinated by miseducation that's global. Think about it. I'm in history class. We all went to history class. My teacher tells me, Leland, Christopher Columbus found this country in 1492. I raise my hand and I say no. The Native Americans, black people, was here first. They tell me no. And if I put that on the test, they mark it wrong. We just talked about the test being racially biased. If you didn't know, the SAT test, which was found by Carl Brigham, who was a racist eugenist, okay? He found this SAT test, and if you really look how we operate, we compare everywhere besides verbal comprehension. And if you study sociology like I do, it's a 40 million word gap between black people in poverty and middle class white people. So if you put certain definitions on a test that we don't identify with, that automatically creates the margin. So you gotta understand that the test scores is the new Jim Crow. Back in the day, it was no whites or no blacks. Now it's just used to, all right, justify why you can't go to school with us. So I think that most of our problems suffer from us because I think that we rely on the same people who have an intention to miseducate us to solve our problems. We can't get nowhere like that. You see what I'm saying? So it's like, I think that the bigger picture of all this, I don't think that we can blame it on the school committee. I don't think that we can blame it on the educational system because it was founded to operate like that anyway. I think that as a community, we need to dig within ourselves and put the responsibility on ourselves to educate our African children on their history. So, I mean, that's pretty much what I wanted to say. And the only question that I have for the superintendent is that if you plan to implant a charter school, right, statistically proven, if you got 4,146 students, out of that 4,000, only 67% of them graduate. That's 2,777 to graduate. Now you still leave 1,369 students unaccounted for. So if you plan on doing that, why don't we get the unions down here to start funding stuff like Southeastern, barbering programs, electricity programs, HVAC programs? Because if you put me in a position to have power, which means to create or operate my reality, now we're talking about equality. But if you educate me to serve, then I'm still a slave since back in 1619, so you never made a difference. So I just want to ask, in our community, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? Because if you leave us in this situation, now you got 1,369 kids who don't have an opportunity to education, and we don't provide them economical opportunity. That looked like crime to me. So I think it's more on us. That's kind of the address that I wanted to put up.
Thank you, Mr. Jackson. Thank you very much. Reverend Walker, Ms. Carmen, big comment.
In fairness to the superintendent, I am certain she's not in favor of charter schools.
Superintendent Smith, a comment to?
It's tough to follow that act. The one thing that I will say is when you look at our educational system in Brockton and you talk about some of those career opportunities, the one thing that I've been pushing since I came on board was looking at our facility master plan for our kids. Because I'm asking all of you, when you talk about our kids, I believe our kids deserve a new Brockton High School with a STEM wing, with those vocational opportunities. And this isn't about Southeastern Regional. Lewis Lopes and I work very closely together. We send over 800 students. As a matter of fact, we have many applicants because of some of the monies the state puts in there, the opportunities at Southeastern. Many of those same opportunities we would love to be providing in our public school system. So one of the things that I'd ask you is the mayor just put together some money, the city council approved it, so that we can have a facility master plan. That means looking at every one of our schools in Brockton and asking ourselves, do we have the technology? Do we have the STEM programs? Do we have 21st century schools? You look around at every one of these surrounding communities. They're building new high schools. West Bridgewater opened up last year. East Bridgewater 2 years before that. Abington has one on the books. Holbrook, they've broken ground. Easton, they've added on. Stoughton just approved it a couple of months ago. What are we doing as a community to make sure that those funds are available so our kids have the best of the best, whether it's vocational, whether it's career, whether it's college bound, and those opportunities? So, that's my comment.
Thank you, Superintendent, and thank you again, Mr. Jackson, for those comments. Next speaker, please introduce yourself.
Hi, my name is Cheyenne Johnson. All right. So, my question is, we always learn about what white people did, what they did at this time. My school this year didn't do anything for Black History Month, nothing at all, except we read two articles. That's it. Okay. Why can't we learn about G. Cook, who invented auto fishing device? Why can't we learn about Martin Luther King and what he did, all the speeches, and except for I Have a Dream? That's like the only thing that we learned at school. Why can't we learn about who invented the eye protector? P. Johnson, right there. But we don't learn any of this stuff. How are we gonna learn about our culture? How are we gonna learn about the people like us that we can follow as a role model from a long time ago if we never learn about this stuff for Black History Month? We just go along with our normal schedule, whatever we do, but it's Black History Month, but we learn nothing about it? Like, that's my question right there.
Thank you very much.
What school do you go to, honey?
I go to Pluff Academy.
Pluff Academy, one of our most wonderful schools, certainly in the district. When I talk about curriculum, you know, we do have curriculum standards, but the teachers, in whatever month that we're celebrating, usually do infuse in their instruction opportunities to have this, especially during Black History Month. I have been invited to certainly numbers of schools. We've had events, children have presented all over the city. Can we do a better job? Obviously we can. So I will address that with the principals that are coming back. I'm meeting with them actually Wednesday of this week. I'll have a dialogue with our teaching and learning curriculum teams and find out why that's not happening district-wide. And we'll look to improve that for you. And please make sure you have an opportunity to follow up with me before you leave tonight. I'll give you a contact information.
Yeah, and just ditto to that, and thank you. What a positive and powerful statement. And how important, I mean, that really encapsulates all of it in a nutshell. Yours, your 18 seconds was much better than my 7 minutes, I assure you. You said everything I was trying to say. Because in truth, that's the real issue, that black history gets encapsulated in a month, and that it's not just infused throughout the curriculum on a daily basis, and that it gets limited to social sciences, and that it's not a part of the math and the science and the physics. It's not part of everything. And in truth, the real losers are the white students. Those are the white, because they grow up thinking this is normative, and this is not the world.
Right.
We're doing those white kids a great disservice. There are literally buildings where the only adult of color is an SCI teacher. What is that saying to white students? And what is the message to other white professionals when they see that happen? That's the real question. It's not really a black or brown issue. It's about folk that call themselves white. Because you're doing those people a great disservice. So I really trust, following your lead, and how good of the superintendent to even add for you to meet with her afterwards. And I trust, and I appreciate the NAACP, and I appreciate Superintendent Smith for being here tonight, and for all of us seeking to find dialogue. I really appreciate that. Because we've got to find a way, not to point blame, but a way to work with the superintendent and to work with the school board. I mean, in honesty, since education reform, what do school committees do? School committees have no power anymore. Only thing school committees get to do since ed reform is hire superintendents. And then it's the superintendent's school. Then superintendents get locked, because you heard us say tonight, through ed reform, principals do the hiring. So at every stage, it just the responsibility and accountability shifts. So nobody has to own up. Why do things stay the way they are? Because of all the rules and processes. So I really trust that we find ways. One of the things NAACP can do is find ways to join hands with the superintendent so that we work together and go to the state board of education and go to the state legislature and say the way you're, the processes and procedures you got schools operating under is blatantly wrong and ensures that white kids will continue to suffer because of what you're doing.
Thank you very much for that comment. And we are really learning from everyone tonight, from the public, the students of all ages, and from our guest speakers. And next person with an introduction. That needs none.
Hello.
But we'll have you introduce
I do
anyway.
Need an introduction. My name is Denise Baker Enegbenabo. Most people here at Messiah know me as Denise Baker. The Mary E. Baker School Elementary School is named after my mother. And when it first opened, I had a chance to, my job allowed me to volunteer there once a month for almost 2 years. I was with Donna Hames, so I came in the morning and I worked with her and I worked with the teachers, and I felt it was a beautiful experience. But what threw me off was what everybody has spoken on, and I think that we're a little bit falling off the point because we're not looking at the history of Brockton. And the history of Brockton plays a really vital role and what's happening at the public school level. And although Brockton High, it's a great school, the school systems are great, okay, I have had many, many friends who have applied and have been, truth be told, overqualified and turned down. Overqualified and turned down, okay, which I felt was disappointing, okay, and then I had other friends who applied who withdrew because they got a better pay in Boston. Okay, the pay was better in Boston. So I found that a little concerning. But the bigger concern for me is that when you look at, it's just disproportionate. You know, and when you look at, you know, when you look at the superintendent's office And then you look at the people you serve. Everybody's already touched on that, so I'm not even going to light that up anymore. You understand what's happening. But I also think we need to look at what's happening in over the years in the city of Brockton. And in the city of Brockton, I have been born and bred here, has had a problem, okay, with privilege. A very severe problem where they felt that they didn't owe anybody answers. You know, that they could hire who they want, okay? And they could take on who they want to take on. And I'm not saying that's been all instances, but that has been the ongoing history in the city of Brockton. Yes, are there black people in places? Yes. So I'm not saying there's not black people, but there are not enough people of color, okay, for the people and the students that you're serving here in here in Brockton. So the question that I want to raise both to the NAACP and to the superintendent is that I think we have to look at how race plays out in this. How race plays out in this and how privilege plays out in this. Because a hiring process, you can say, yes, it's the principal's responsibility to hire, okay, but ultimately it still goes by your desk. It still goes by your desk, maybe, okay? And what I'm saying is, if you're saying that you're not getting enough qualified candidates, me personally, then I would have to push back. And I'm gonna invite everybody in this room who pays taxes, okay? I don't care if you're black or white, we need to push harder, okay? We need to push harder because the city has constantly use the word, we haven't had enough qualified candidates, okay? They don't have their the testing eligibility, whereas there's other teachers who still don't have their certification and are being zoomed through and waited and given chances to move along to get along when other qualified people are being told, come back. Apply when we have another opening, then there's not another opening. So I think we have to look at how privilege is playing into this. And I know this is an ouch, and I apologize in advance. I totally apologize. But on both sides, we need to take a look at how, when we're hiring people, you know, is it because they're truly not qualified? Is it because they, you know, they don't meet the base criteria? Is it because the principal doesn't like the way they look? You know, or the principal doesn't like the way their hair is? You know what I mean? Like, what are we looking at? And that all falls under privilege. You know, and I hate to raise this, but I've been born in the city all my life. And I have seen handshakes at the table, behind the table, behind the door, upside the door. Okay, but when you're looking at coming together, and I hope this is a coming together, and I was so excited at work. I work in Boston. I looked at it, I saw his article, and I'm like, tonight, I gotta go. Okay, what's going on? We got a coming together. So this is a great opportunity. But let me just step over to the white side for a minute. I think you need to understand how privilege plays out in how teachers get hired, how janitors get hired, how security gets hired, okay? And I just want you to see it from our eyesight. And that's what I think is missing. That's what I'm talking about when I talk about privilege, okay? If you can't see it from a person of color's eyesight, then you don't understand how we feel, okay? Well, you don't understand. I've had four friends. They all have their masters calling me, talking about, I didn't make it. What are you talking about, you didn't make it? You're overqualified. I was embarrassed, because here I am, I love my city. They ended up going to Boston. Why did that have to happen? You know, that's a sin and a shame. Considering, when you look at the numbers, just take Brockton High. Okay, when I didn't go, I graduated from Cardinal Spellman, All my friends went to Brockton High School. But when we were up there, we were fighting for our lives at that time. We had all kinds of race issues up there. Okay? But now that has shifted, so that now when I walk through Brockton High School, I see more of me than I see of you. I see more of me than I see of you. And what I'm saying is, I just want you to understand, and I promise I'm not trying to offend anybody, but on both sides, it's about time Brockton, as a whole, started to take a look at how privilege plays out on how people get jobs, how people get contracts, okay? That all matters. And since we are gonna have this open dialogue here, and I think this is a total blessing because Brockton has never done this. Brockton has never done this.
Denise, thank you very much. I think there's a question and maybe several questions in there, and I'd like to give an opportunity to both Superintendent Smith to answer and Reverend Walker to answer or make comments to any part of those questions. We're running short of time, so I would ask the people who are going to be asking questions to be more direct in their questions and respectfully, less in their personal commentary, so that others can be heard. I'd like to get all the way back to Dr. Howard. So let's.
All right. Please, I will certainly bow to the counselor, and I'll just wait for all of you, and I'll just give my comments at the end. I'll jot whatever.
Superintendent, you have comments.
I will address. First of all, you know, having not been superintendent, I'm sorry, is it Denise?
Denise.
I'm sorry. I want to tell you that I was very proud that a woman finally had a school named after her in Brockton, and more proud that it was the Mary Baker School. Because whether you want to hear this or not, and you don't want to hear this tonight, you know, I am the first woman superintendent in the Brockton Public Schools. I consider that breaking the ceiling. You're right. You know, I as superintendent and as the leader of this district, I do try to put myself in somebody else's shoes. And I do not think that tonight is where we have this dialogue. I do think we come up with a way to talk about some of the nuances. As I said, I'd love to have my directors, my associate directors of HR, sit and talk with you about the things that are very, very difficult, whether people want to admit this or not, with the Board of Education. You can have a doctorate, and you might not qualify under the terms of what you have to do for licensure, certification, to become an administrator or a teacher or a principal or a supervisor or a director. And yes, there are opportunities for what they call waivers. Waivers do not last very long. Usually we have waivers, again, with our bilingual staff, you know, looking to get certain credentials, bringing people on board and trying to work with them. I think this is excellent dialogue. I do commit to trying to walk in your shoes, to trying to find out how, and I did bring with me, and I'll leave this here, this is ed reform, and it does talk about, as I said, the principal is the hiring authority for their school. And as I mentioned, accountability lies with the principal. If the students aren't achieving, if in fact they are considered a level 4 school, and we are very fortunate, we are the only urban district in this state that has not had a level 4 school yet. We're hanging by a thread. And the reason, again, lies in the fact that the principal is thrown out of the job, 50% of the teachers have to be replaced by law. So it is in the hands of the principal. The superintendent can approve or disapprove. If in fact the superintendent disapproves a hire, it goes back to the principal to bring other candidates forward. That doesn't answer if there are people out there that have the licensure, have the certifications, and are not getting jobs in the system. We have to take a look at that. You know, I said it again, do we as a community come together and make sure that we look at interviewing skills, that we look at making sure people have resumes, portfolios, and those opportunities, and put myself in those shoes? So I do think that whatever comes out of tonight is an opportunity to put something together. I was pleased when the mayor put together a diversity commission, and Bishop Branch, I know, is heading that up. And I was sitting at the NAACP breakfast. I sat beside the mayor when he announced it. And I said, Mayor, please can we put a representative of the Brockton Public Schools on that commission for a lot of the issues that keep coming up, issues that our youth are bringing up. You know, things that we need to do and have the impetus and the support of the community and certainly the mayor. And we do have a Brockton High teacher, Dee Smith, who is serving on that commission. And I think whether this comes off of that commission, we'll have to talk about how we put together a task force, and let's see what kind of a difference we can make. So again, thank you very much.
Thank you, Superintendent. So I golfed both on Friday and Monday. One would ask, do I ever work? But what I know is if my first drive is right down the middle, 250 yards, it doesn't matter if my second shot is in the woods. It's very, very important that the next move that we make is a very effective move, that we choose the right club and practice what we've learned and execute the proper technique in problem solving. So we'll be doing that. What we learned tonight, we'll bring together people that can determine in a short period of time what the next step will be, and you'll all be involved and informed of when the next dialogue will continue. Our next speaker, introduce yourself, please.
Okay, Shayna Barnes. I am a member of the City Council, Councilor at Large. I'm here, I guess, as the only city councilor here. I don't see any of my colleagues here because they're probably at the meeting, but I felt it was very important for me to be here and to represent at least the council and the administrative offices of the city of Brockton. One thing that I heard here today that I actually wasn't really going to speak about was somebody brought up something about doing a collaborative effort with our state legislature. That is why, actually, I called State Representative Russell Holmes. And he's sitting over there now, and I really commend him for being here because he's right off of vacation, and he came down here at my request. And I wanted him to come down because a lot of us don't know who he is. Some of us may have met him back when I ran for state rep, but a lot of us, we don't know who he is, and we need to in the city of Brockton. He is the chairman of the Black and Latino Caucus at the State House. He has the ear of the speaker in the state representative's offices. So we need to know who he is. If we're having these issues here, and if these kids are coming forward with these issues as of late, and I know this young man, Bradley Souffrant, I've not really spoken with him intimately, but I've heard the things that he's done and the challenges that he has stood up for. And those are things that need not go unnoticed. And I appreciate you for bringing those things forward, because other students and other kids may not have had that confidence to come out and to say, this is what's happening. This is how it directly and indirectly affects me, my colleagues, my teachers, my new deans, assistant deans, and the principals of our school system. So thank you. But we need to make sure that our issues here in Brockton don't get unrecognized by our state legislature. He is here, he is representative of, like I said, the Black and Latino Caucus, and that is why we're here, to make sure that we envelop everyone and put our arms around everybody around this issue. Because everybody gets affected, correct? Correct. So I just want to make sure maybe we can start that dialogue with our state DOE folks and with our state delegation to see what we can do to make Brockton High how it's supposed to look outside of these 8 square miles of Brockton. We need to let other people know what's going on here in Brockton, and that is the way to do that, to highlight our achievements and to make sure that our kids are being celebrated, as well as our teachers to be celebrated for what they're doing and the job that they have to do. I couldn't do it. My mom did it for 49 years. I couldn't do it. And the teachers that are here now today, God bless them as well. God bless them waking up every morning for 180 days in the snow, in the sun, with no air conditioning, no supplies, having to use their own money to buy supplies for their kids so that our kids don't get caught behind, so that we are globally competitive with everybody else that's out there. And I commend you also, Superintendent Smith, for what you're doing and pushing that with us. You collect us every year, at least once a year. You come to the city council and you give a state of the schools address, and you let us know the good, the bad, the ugly, and the in-between. And I do appreciate you for doing that. But I will say this, and maybe this is something that can get on the agenda for when you all really start to really delve into these issues and look for these questions. Mr. Dawkins actually brought it up. He's gone. But what is the makeup, and I ask you this every year, and Deputy Superintendent Thomas, he knows it as well. What is the makeup of the of-color administrators at 43 Crescent? And also, I guess they did some changing or something over at Foster Street. And I'm not here to indict you or anything, and I really do hope that we can continue our relationship. I have a great relationship with you. But every year when I ask you that, you kind of do this, and you look back, and we never get an answer. And Councilor Rodriguez and I, we talked about that. And there was a gentleman actually here earlier. He was like, are you going to ask the same question that you've asked? Since I've been on the council for these last 3 years, I've asked that same question. And I never get an answer. And this question was asked again tonight. And what you did was you went through all of the classroom availabilities and the openings, but you didn't really mention the administrator. He specifically said 43 Crescent Street, the Crosby Building. So I'm just going to reiterate that now. If you want to answer that now, that's fine. But I definitely want to make sure that that is one of the agenda items that we all talk about in going forward as we, again, like I said, make these collaborative relationships with the state, with all of these other agencies. So thank you.
So Kathleen Smith, Superintendent Kathleen Smith, your name has been called.
Sure. I think one of the first people I want to look at, is it Representative? I'm sorry, I didn't catch the name. Representative Holmes. So those of you that watched what happened in Brockton this past year, and when you do mention the duties of the school committee, they have policy, which is big. It is the running of the school district. It isn't just hiring the superintendent, and it is the matter of the budget. And they put in hours upon hours upon hours for our kids and making sure they have the resources. So our legislators worked very, very hard this year, and I'm looking forward to having a breakfast with them next week. But when you look at, and I think it was Ms. Baker who mentioned about when she goes up to Brockton High right now, it's quite a bit different than when she probably graduated from high school many, many years ago, because we have close to 80% minority students, and that's really throughout our district. So looking at what happened in the legislature this year, we hung on in Brockton because of a new funding formula that came down called direct certification. When we had about an 80% free and reduced lunch poverty level, which makes a difference when you rely on about 80% of your funding from the state. And what happened with Governor Baker, and to me this is shameful, they put in a new system. They did not pay attention to a review commission that was out there for months that Brockton was at every step of the way, and this was all over the state. We had a representative every time that they had this commission put together and look at funding formulas. So in the end, when we hung on for that little bit of money that went for additional student support throughout the state, Easton got it based on their total enrollment. Brockton got it based on our total enrollment. It was about 55 additional dollars per student. And the state thinks that's equity. Well, it's not equity, because in the end, when that money came in, and it was $618,000, and let me tell you, I was hanging on every bit of that, because that was going to make a difference with the 32 teachers I still don't have back that won't open school on September 1st. And what happened was, in an urban district like ours, when that money stayed put with the legislature, we lost $486,000 in a kindergarten grant that Easton didn't lose. They didn't qualify. We're an urban district. That mattered to have an additional para in a kindergarten classroom with 25 students, when Easton, I'm sure, has probably 15 kindergarten kids in a class. They didn't lose the almost $100,000 that Brockton High lost, an academic support grant that we've had for probably 20 years. It helps with SAT prep, credit recovery, those little programs that make a difference for those students to so-called get a leg up when you're talking an urban center. So we do have a lot of work to do, and our state legislators have put in hours and hours, but I really welcome you. You know, if you're there and you're talking about what we need as an urban district, you've seen our Brockton Kids Count campaign. We need to come together about so many issues, but we need you there. We actually have the Commissioner of Education choosing Brockton on September 20th to come in to have a dialogue with our parents and our community. It'll be the kickoff campaign for this year's Brockton Kids Count, and also we'll be addressing our school committee that very evening. So these are the kind of things that we have to have dialogue about if we're talking about resourcing our kids in an urban center. And Shana, I have figures right here as far as, when you talk about figures, I have figures from the EEOC, the Equal Education Opportunity Commission, that looks at administrators, looks at teachers, looks at, it breaks it down completely. And we have those figures right here for the closest we've reported, which I think is about a year or so ago. We also have, if you go on the DESE website, it lists all of those positions. So I don't always have them off the top of my head, but I have them here tonight, and I'm very glad to share them. You can take all of the graphs, the information. I did not want to get bogged down in graphs. I wanted to have dialogue. You know, we know that it's an issue. I will say this, that when you look at urban districts, Boston has the largest number of minority teachers, administrators, et cetera, in Boston. When you look at around the state, and I'm talking higher than Worcester, higher than Springfield, you know, Brockton is number two. Is it good enough? It's not good enough. And as I said, I did not want to get bogged down with facts and figures. I'm glad to leave them with the NAACP, and you can certainly share and do a fact check on those figures.
Thank you very much, Superintendent.
And I want to thank Councilor Barnes, because I agree. Our city council and our school committee have been excellent. You've come together for so many things. I know you're always there supporting the kids, and I enjoy, you know, coming before you and always feel like it's sometimes difficult conversations, but dialogue in the best interest of our kids.
So we're coming up, we're at the 9 o'clock hour. There are two people standing before us. This is your opportunity to be heard, and I do want to give these people an opportunity to be heard. But I would ask that no one stand behind Mr. Brewer, my first vice president. So you can maybe make sure that happens, okay? Our next speaker, please introduce yourself.
Hi, my name is Marlene Amidi. I'm the president of the Haitian Community Partners. I just want to commend you, Reverend Burke. Forget your name. Could you really that? We'll call you Baker. Walk it's too long of a day. And thank you, Superintendent Smith, for being here tonight. Two points that I want to make. One from this gentleman over there that said that we want to change things, but we're leaving it to the same people that created the mess to change. So what are we planning to do about it? So that's my challenge to this great organization as a social justice organization. I think the problem that we have in Brockton, it's not only in Brockton. It's almost everywhere. So we've been in a system that promoted that for a long time. It's a chronic illness, that social injustice. So what are we planning to do to eradicate that social injustice? So it's not something that we wake up one day, it's happening. It's been there forever, and we live on it. Your child, you grew up on it. You raise your child on it. So I'm raising my child in that system as well. So what, as community, as organization, as churches, what are we planning to do about that system? What are we planning to do? We can call many people here. We can call city councilors, we can call state web, we can call senators. But we have to take some responsibilities as well, because we are the one who putting them there. What is our agenda? What we telling them to do with our vote when we putting them there? That system we've been in it for a long time. I think it's time. It's time. It's about time. Thank you for this opportunity to bring it to light. Thank you so much. It's time that we work together as community to put forward a plan so we can change that system. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can Walker make a just short comment to them? Okay. William Brewer will be our last questioner. And then I'll give both Reverend Walker and Kathleen Smith a brief close so we end strongly. But William, take your time and
okay. Go ahead.
Please introduce yourself.
William Brewer, first vice president of ACP. First I want to do is make an announcement by one of our guests who had left early, and they're having a public and police partnership for peace forum. It's a community conversation connected with the correction system. That's on Wednesday, September 14th at 6:30 at the War Memorial Building. And it's sponsored by New Life Christian Church, Pastor Orlando Harris.
Okay. I read Tom Minicello, is it?
Please introduce yourself.
I don't know how to pronounce your last name, huh?
Please introduce yourself.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm Joan Madden. I'm a member of this church. But anyway, I read your comment to Pastor Walker's blog that he wrote, and I'd like to know how you feel now that we've had this forum. Would you like to share that with us? Okay.
Mr. Brewer, continue.
That's okay. I did have a couple of questions. I'll be brief. One of the things that came out of tonight is when you can, hearing the guests speak here, they talk about a system where there's a structural problem. And the structural problem, if you don't change the structural problem, you're going to continue to have the problem. And so when they talk about principals hiring, do you believe a principal is going to risk his career over hiring teachers that he's taking a risk on, a chance on? So he's going to go to teachers who look like him, and that's who's going to look to hire. And so we've got a structural problem that we need to address, we need to change. And I was really happy to read your article. It was provoking. And that's what our pastors need to do, provoke us. And that's how we make change. And so what I want to say tonight is that this is a great first step. We talk about committees. Hearing a couple of the guests talk about people who would come for jobs and didn't get any interviews or was denied, I think what we need to do is track that so we have some data to show that. And so we need to really work together. And the last thing I wanted to ask is, you talked about, Superintendent, that there were 34 people in this program with master's degrees that you're going to sort of pipeline. And I would like to know how many of those people were people of color.
I think you're talking about the administrative internship program. I can give you... I'll give you some statistics. So as I said, we have a job ad that goes out, you know, for this. Usually it's around,
what I'm trying to look for is just how many people out of the 34 were African-American, Haitian?
Well, you know, very simply, you know, it's coming from our teaching staff. I just want to make that clear. So you have to be a member of the Brockton. It's part of the Brockton Education Association teacher contract to give opportunities for administrative internships, we call them.
Okay.
So over the past couple of years, and that's why I mentioned, you know, to get in, you have to have 5 years teaching experience, you have to have a master's degree and an interest in administrative internships. So in 2013, we had 31 white applicants, 3 black, 1 Asian. We selected 10, 9 white, 1 black. March of 2014, there were 30 white, 6 black, 2 Asian. 14 were selected, 11 were white, 3 were black. March of 2015, 28 white, 2 black applicants, 1 Asian. 9 were selected, 7 white, 2 black. In March of 2016, which would have been this past group, we had 32 white applicants, 2 black, 1 Asian, 1 Hispanic. We did select a total of 9. It was 7 whites, 1 black, and 1 Asian.
Okay, thank you.
I'll leave those with you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Thanks again.
Okay, we had a request to have Tom Minicello come to the podium, and I'll do that. But I would be remiss if I didn't fulfill my responsibility to you in asking you now to pass to Leona. Would you get some system of collecting the questionnaire so that we can accomplish one of the goals that we've come here to accomplish, and that is to find out and quantify the reasons for being here. BCA is televising this, so we'll have a tape of your comments, and we'll be able to make that second shot, pick the right club, and use the right technique to make certain that the plan is foolproof and going forward. Now, I had a conversation with Mr. Minicello earlier today, and I hope that your comments are not as long as our conversation, particularly because of the hour. And yet, I appreciate your and respect your willingness to speak. But I'm the boss tonight, and I'd like you to keep your comments to 3 minutes. Is that good enough?
You set the rules, Steve.
Yeah, you got it. I like that. Mr. Minicello is the chair of the school committee?
Vice chair. The mayor's the chair.
And after we hear from Mr. Minicello, I'll ask Reverend Walker first, okay? And then Kathy Smith to wrap up very, very briefly. And I'd appreciate it if you would all stay to hear them rather than getting up and leaving, because that just sort of takes away from the effect of ending strongly. So with that, please, Tom.
Good evening, everyone. And I certainly would like to thank you, Steve, for holding this forum tonight. My name is Tom Minicello. I'm the vice chair of the school committee. I've lived in Brockton my entire life. I attended the Ashfield School. I attended East Junior High. I went to Brockton High School. In my lifetime in Brockton, Brockton's a wonderful place. I view Brockton as a very diverse community. And I just think if you live in Brockton, you're exposed to many things that unfortunately people in other communities have no knowledge of or exposure to. With respect to my comments in response to the Reverend's editorial, someone here said that words matter. I think this is a great dialogue in terms of, you know, the issues that need to be raised, but I think there's a way to present things. And, you know, some of the words that the Reverend used, I found offensive and I found not applicable. For instance, you know, do the members of the Brockton School Committee disrespect black and brown Brocktonians? Clearly they do. Clearly I don't. I don't disrespect black and brown people in Brockton. We live amongst each other. We interact with each other. My children go to the Brockton Public Schools. I have children of color in and out of my house all the time. My family adopted children who would be considered brown. So I don't disrespect black and brown people, nor do I believe the superintendent of schools does. Are there things to talk about? Are there issues that need to be discussed? Absolutely. But I think these were very harsh words, and I think they should have been chosen a little more carefully. You know, that was my point. I was disturbed that this is the first dialogue I've ever had with respect to this issue, and the Reverend Walker. It was not even a dialogue. I've seen the Reverend on several of occasions, out and about. We are cordial to each other. We say hello. We interact. Never have I ever been approached and said, hey, there's something I need to talk to you about. There's something that's disturbing me. There's something that needs to be done. I don't think this is the first shot across the bow that I should be informed that there's an issue that he'd like to discuss. I just think the methods were harsh, and I think there's a better way to come up with a solution. There's many people in this room that I consider my friends, and you know, we've done some interesting things lately in terms of making some changes that needed to be changed, and we did that together. Bradley came to the school committee and talked about certain issues. We listened. We made some changes. Bradley's been, you know, the last time Bradley was at the school committee meeting, he was very polite, respectful. I was impressed with what he said. We moved together and we did some changes. I just think there's a better way in terms of creating harmony in Brockton rather than, in my opinion, you know, insulting the entire school committee and insulting the superintendent and implying that, you know, we're racist. I mean, to basically say, well, they probably never use the N-word unless they're the Mark Furman type. Well, I found that offensive. I don't think that way. No one on the school committee thinks that way. And no one who thinks that way belongs in Brockton. We live in a very diverse community. And I think it was a great discussion. I think this is a good discussion that should have taken place. I just think it didn't have to be brought about with what I would consider pretty strong and disturbing words, in my opinion. But I think it was a great dialogue. People raised great issues. And there's work to be done. But I think we're willing to work together. And reading this didn't tell me that someone wanted to work together. It was like, you know, it was an ambush as far as I was concerned. And, you know, I just thought that it could have been done in a more civilized way. That's all. And you know, I feel very comfortable in this church, with amongst everyone in this church, because, you know, there are issues that need to be talked about. No one disputes that, but, you know, words have meaning, and I think these were very strong words, and, you know, to be labeled in this way, I didn't think was true, and I found it disturbing. That's all.
Thank you very much, Tom. So we'd like to, in the program as we began, by allowing both Reverend Walker and Kathy Smith to end this evening, but to begin a continuing dialogue where we will be working together as a community to resolve these problems and to improve our product, to make certain that we continue to be among the best in Massachusetts. So let's hear from Reverend Walker.
This is, what's this, 2016? Everybody loves Muhammad Ali. Everybody loves Martin Luther King. How many white folk liked Martin Luther King in 1964? How many white folk liked Malcolm, well, I'll say Malcolm, liked Cassius Clay when Cassius became Muhammad in 1966? We love folk in abstracto when they do things the proper way and use civilized words and the words that white folks see as acceptable. It's unfortunate that, and I appreciate the brother and the sister in particular. There's a fine book, Martin, Malcolm, and America, by James Cone, Martin, Malcolm, and America. And Cone calls it, the subtitle of the book is A Dream or a Nightmare. And one of the things he says in there is that people in America want racial reconciliation, but they're not willing to work for racial justice. And I think what we're asking and hoping for from this tonight, not necessarily racial reconciliation, but racial justice. And if reconciliation flows from that justice, beautiful. But part of that problem with racial reconciliation, Quentin Dixon says, and it's Dixie, D-I-X-I-E, Dixie, in The Courage to Hope, says that America, the problem with America, he says, is that America is a hotel society. And by hotel society, the light is always on. Whenever you show up, you're welcome, because the light is always on. And there are some issues in our society that's in the dark. There are some people in our society that's left in the dark, and we're more comfortable with them being in the dark. But in our society, we just keep the light on and just talk about those things that are in the light. And then if I bring up the dark, now I'm the villain. I just wonder, when I hear budget, when I hear rules, when I hear processes, when I hear procedures, when I hear practices, that's all fine. But none of that stuff dropped out of the sky. Whatever hiring practices are in place, whatever rules are in place, whatever procedures are in place, somebody wrote those. And then they can write them and back away as if there's some impersonal system that just happens. One of the real problems, I'll just read exactly what I wrote here. I really wish people would read, it's a great brother by the name of Tim Wise, W-I-S-E. Tim Wise tells a story of when he was in college. He went to Tulane in New Orleans. He went to school in New Orleans, and you know how the public, those of you that's been to New Orleans know Tulane's not far. Nowhere in New Orleans too far from a housing project. But anyway, Tim Wise, W-I-S-E. Tim Wise says that one night he went out, he and his friends went out partying. He got drunk. Got home, well, to his dorm room. Went in his dorm room, woke up about 2-3 in the morning, still drunk. Had his underwear, boxer shorts, and a t-shirt. And remembered that he was drunk when he got home. left his keys and his wallet and everything in his car. So he gets up 2-3 in the morning, still half drunk, walks to his car, he says. And then he says he's there half drunk, but he's trying to break in his car. The police comes up, and the police officer stops and gets out and says, I'll help you. And the police officer got that thing that police use and unlocked the door to help him break in his car. And Tim Y says, suppose I had been black and I'm breaking in a car. He was able to break in a car, and the police helped him break in his car because of his skin color. And that's a privilege. That's a privilege that a black student at Tulane would not have been afforded. They would not have been assumed to be breaking in their own car. That would have been a problem. And there's one other book that I highly recommend that everybody that calls themselves white here read. It's by Carol Anderson, A-N-D-E-R-S-O-N. Carol Anderson is a historian. She's a professor of history at Emory University. She's a professor of history there at Emerson. And the book just came out, back in January, February, just came out this year. But anyway, the title of the book, Carol Anderson, she's a professor of history. The title of the book is White Rage, R-A-G-E, White Rage. And what Carol Anderson says in the book, and she dates it all the way back to the founding of a country, to 1916. But what she says, essentially what she says in the book is simply this. She says that every time there has been a movement for black progress, usually through legislatures and through the courts, every time there's been a movement for black progress, white rage comes up to squash it down. She uses 1865, Civil Rights Emancipation Proclamation, and that lasted Reconstruction, 12 years. 1877, Jim Crow, poll taxes. 1954, Brown versus Board, and then what did schools do? Schools in the South segregated. Talk about tax dollars. Tax dollars are then used to fund segregated schools in the South for tax dollars. And then even now, she brings it all the way up to today with Black Lives Matter. And now folk can't stand to hear Black Lives Matter, and white rage rises up again. So in fact, and I shouldn't be personal here, but if you read my letter carefully, if you read it carefully, and I'll be real honest with you, the Enterprise actually changed a word in it. So if you want to see the actual letter I wrote, I'll happily show it to you. But I did not put N word. I don't say N word. I say nigger. So the letter did not say N word. I didn't say N word. So if you want to see the original letter with the exact wording, I'll happily share it. What I said in the letter, if you read it carefully, was simply, take a test, walk any day of the week, walk to 43 Crescent Street. I didn't call anybody racist. It's not for me to do. I don't know who's racist or who's not, but I do know if you're racially insensitive. I don't know if you're racist or not, but I do know if we've got a problem in the city and you don't see it, until I write a letter that you don't like, and now it's a problem? The problem was there already. If I come to your house, and I turn the light on, and then rats and roaches start running around, well, I didn't bring the roaches, I just turned the light on. So why blame me for the roaches? If I turn the light on, then that's not my issue. What's running around? Address that instead of addressing me. Address the problem. All I said in the letter is walk through 43 Crescent Street any day, and I just want you to get a sheet of paper, use your fingers, and just count the number of blacks and browns you see in upper-level jobs. Take that test. Just walk through 43 Crescent. And if you don't see a problem with that, then my letter or nothing else is going to wake you up. And if it takes a letter from me to say there's a problem when you walk through 43 Crescent, something's wrong. And it's not 80 Legion Parkway.
Thank you, Reverend Walker. And the last speaker we'll hear is Superintendent Kathy Smith. Superintendent.
Thank you. First of all, I want to thank everybody for having me here this evening. I'm not going to tell you this was easy. As a matter of fact, it made me uncomfortable. It was difficult conversation, and that's okay.
That's a good thing.
But I do want to say to Reverend Walker, I do believe words matter. And I understand I heard every word you just said. I listened to every word that you said. But, you know, clearly, when something like that is written, I do believe the dialogue would have happened without some of those comments that I found very divisive. So I want to be able to say that to you. Because I will face 18,000 students in the next couple of weeks. And you're right, I owe those students something. I owe them a look at the curriculum. I owe them to make sure that there are things that happen, not just Black History Month, but things where we honor your history, our history. And I love the idea of our students, white and black, understanding why we're all so important in this society. So I love it. I probably could use an education in that. More importantly than that, when those students look at me, I need them not to look at me with words that are racist and words that talk about their superintendent in a way that is very, very negative. Granted, I want them to look at a superintendent that makes some changes, that sits down with the communities, takes a look at actual challenges, and whether we want to hear it or not, and we can look at 43 Crescent Street. It isn't just about turning a light on. There are challenges. There's ways that we can come together. I'm going to hand you out tonight applications for jobs for paraprofessionals, applications for monitor teacher assistants, jobs we can't fill. So you need to come forward as a community. So find those people that are able to come in any place, because remember, I have students. And whether we like it or not, we have things that we have to mandate before people can be with students. And I look at us as, I don't care if you're white, I don't care if you're black. You know, we've got to look at things to make sure that when students are in front of us, and whether we like it or not, there's CORI reports, now there's fingerprint reports. So we need people from this community to come in and volunteer, to come in and apply for jobs. So all of that will be here for you today. I'll leave all of the statistics and the information. And when we do come together again, and hopefully it's sooner than later, so I'm going to ask them, the NAACP, Reverend Walker, please join us at the table. I will make it a priority with our human resource office. I will speak to our principals, and we will come up with a plan of action. One of the things I'll leave, and I believe I have copies of a plan of action of the Grow Your Own program. So hopefully, and I'm sure I won't be here anymore in this position anyway, that when we start to look 10 years down the road, you have done and we have done an excellent job with the Grow Your Own. Because I look at the young men sitting here, actually quiet tonight, which kind of surprises me, guys. But are you willing to go into teaching? Are you willing to go out there and get that credential and come back and give back to your community? I had a high school group of, the best thing that I do at Brockton High and Principal Wolder allows me to come in and speak to seniors, juniors, sophomores, freshmen, and I end with the seniors again. I call it the superintendent listening tour. I get to go, I have about 20, 25 youngsters, we have lunch together. I love the dialogue. It's also not easy dialogue with them. They ask a lot of really tough questions and they want answers. And one of the things they said to me recently was they said, Superintendent, why don't we have teachers in front of us that look like us? And you can imagine when you talk about 20, 25 youngsters, you know, sitting there, we have 80% minority students at Brockton High. They look like that population, the students that Principal Wolder brings forward to have dialogue with me. And I looked back at them and I said to them, okay, guys, how many of you are going into education? And they were going to Tulane. They were going to Harvard. They were going to excellent colleges. Ask me how many hands were raised. There were none. So that belongs to all of us to find out. And, you know, I have two daughters. They're 30 and 33 years old. Somehow I spent a lot of time telling them that they needed to go into something else. One is a social worker in a psychiatric hospital in Texas. The other works as a communications person for the air traffic controllers in D.C. Neither went into education. And part of me regrets that. I think there were kids that had a heart. They would have probably been wonderful. My daughter in Washington continually takes part in a program reading to students in the public schools there. So I say that because all of us have to take a look at our own children in our own homes. You know, are you encouraging your daughter to go into education? You know, are people doing those kind of things and saying this is a valuable profession? It probably, again, is on my part to lead the district, so we're marketing these things with our own teachers, bringing in speakers, you know, talking about the kind of profession it is. Because you will see teachers, you will see those administrators, you will see the superintendent who looks like our community. So, again, I want to thank you for having me here this evening, and I hope we continue with this dialogue. Thank you.
And so we end this evening with the promise that we'll go to the next shot. The way to end the program is to say thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you for coming out tonight and beginning what will be beginning of a new era in Brockton, dialogue with results. Thank you, Reverend Walker. Thank you, Superintendent Smith. Thank you, everyone. Have a good night.